Wednesday, July 27, 2016, council meeting to order. If everybody could please rise for a silent prayer, a moment of reflection, please. Flag salute. A pledge of allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coaster and the Star Ledger on January 6, 2016, and posted on a bulletin board the same date. Notices are on file with the city clerk. We have four proclamations this evening. The first proclamation is recognizing Jackie Pappas, Executive Director from the Asbury Park Chamber of Commerce.
Jackie's coming.
proclamation supporting the move of Garden State Equality to the city of Asbury Park.
We have a lot of proclamations on tonight.
This is Robin.
For women, Peter Paul was at the DNC. Whereas Garden State Equality is New Jersey's statewide advocacy education organization for the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender community. And whereas Garden State Equality is collaboration with community partners led efforts to ensure non-discrimination for transgender and gender non-conforming people in New Jersey. We have passed the most comprehensive anti-bullying law in the country, ended sexual orientation and gender identity expression change efforts in New Jersey, sometimes called conversion therapy, and brought marriage equality to the Garden State. Whereas in an effort to guarantee better service to the community, Garden State Equality deemed it necessary to move to a location which would be better accessible under the Americans with Disabilities Act. Whereas Garden State Equality has decided that the place for them to continue in their mission of pursuing advocacy and equality for the LGBTQ community is here in Asbury Park. Now therefore, be resolved and commend Garden State Equality for their commitment to the empowerment of all genders. And we have further resolved that the mayor and council welcome Garden State Equality to Asbury Park and look forward to a long-lasting partnership. And just so everyone knows, Garden State Equality opened their offices on Main Street at, next to Frank's Deli.
Next proclamation is a proclamation recognizing Chelsea Kay's tenure as AmeriCorps Vista for the Asbury Park Community Development Initiative. As Yvonne goes down.
Hard work they create for the community.
The last proclamation for this evening is a proclamation for fibrodysplasia officiants progressiva FOP awareness. Did I do good?
Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Books. This is Atlantic County to Monmouth County, and in Monmouth County, where you guys are, community members, there's only five municipalities left in all of Monmouth County. But overall, in the 566 mayors, we have Asbury Park will make the 470 proclamation or resolution that we received to date. And the good news about these books is that last year we were asked by the New Jersey Historical Society that they want to take these books on their bench and add them to their archives and collection. So thank you very much for your support. I appreciate it. Thank you, Mayor. Thank you, Council.
All right, we'll move on to matters from City Council. Anybody have quick matters?
Yes, I have one. You want to start?
Go ahead, Chelsea.
First of all, I want to go on record by saying this is, what I have to say is not directed to one particular person or one particular group. I would say two Mondays ago, as you all know, we have the Springwood Avenue concert, and it was a beautiful performance. But what was more beautiful than that was our specials and a few other gracious people that love playing with kids got out there and started playing with the kids. And I'd like to thank Darlene's husband for bringing it to my attention. And what they did was they started taking pictures. But the comment that came to him was this, and he also addressed it to me. These are the type of things that we need to do. It's a lot of concerned people, and a lot of kids do, a lot of concerned people put their hearts out. And I like to give credit to the specials that was out there. There was one police officer and also your husband. But the main point is this. We're going to have to put a little bit more fire into our communication. Reason is, I also got a call from Mr. Perry. I shouldn't call his name, but, and we talked about the musical. And Mr. Perry had been around here for 50 years or 60 years. He was in Asbury High School, and they didn't not get any publicity as they should. And I apologize to him and for the council and all. But what I'm saying is this. We're going to have to find a way to put a little bit more fire in our communication. Thank you. And we will.
Anybody?
Yeah, and I'd like to follow up on Jesse's comment that the concerts on Monday night in Springwood Park are wonderful. They're free. They're open to the public. We also have the Asbury Park Concert Band on the boardwalk. We've got the Asbury Live Concerts. There's so many opportunities to get out to see music and see events and interact with your community. I just hope everyone takes advantage of that.
And Clement Weber, we have it at the presentation.
Yes, that's a good point, Jesse. And the Monday night Springwood Concerts, if there's inclement weather, they get moved to the transit building, so they're not canceled.
I just want to remind people that on Friday, August 5th at 7 p.m. will be the next expungement session at St. Stephen's AME Church. And if you know anyone who would benefit from it, please have them come out. Thank you.
Good. All right, we'll move on to matters from the city manager. We have the report of audit by our city auditor, Mr. Kaplan.
And you know what? Can I just say one thing? So with the air conditioning out, it's actually affecting the sound. So anyone who's watching this at home or online after we edit them and air them, and you're having a problem with the sound, we know. And we apologize.
Good to go. Good evening, everyone. We've completed our audit of the City of Asbury Park for the years ended December 31st, 2015 and 14. We issued our report after 6 or 7 weeks of field work and then discussing it with the administration. Our independent auditor's report is dated July 20th, 2016, and it's an unmodified opinion on the regulatory basis of accounting, which means that the Division of Local Government Services sets forth the way that New Jersey municipalities have to account for and report their financial transactions. Our audit report says that you have complied with the regulatory basis of accounting. So that's an unmodified opinion. That's what you want to get, and I'm happy to report that's what we issued. A couple financial performance highlights. As of 12/31/15, this is a snapshot as of that date, as of that time, the current fund, which is the main operating fund of the city, had a fund balance of $4.758 million. That's compared to 2014 when you had about $3.4 million, an increase of about $1.3 million, or almost 40%. So that's by far the highest current fund balance that the city has ever had in its history. And just for reference, in 2010, you had a whopping $115,000 surplus. So you've come a long way in the current fund in a short period of time. Same thing with the beach utility. 12/31/15, $961,000, up from $728,000. Again, a record surplus for the city. By comparison, in 2013, you had $130,000 in fund balance. Beach revenues are $1.8 million in 2015, up almost $600,000 from 2014's level. And the story goes on with parking utility, $1.5 million fund balance, up $366,000, again, a record. Parking fees were almost $3.1 million in 2015, up about $700,000 from the prior year. So those three, those are the bright spots. You also run a sewer utility. Not as good in the sewer utility. Sewer utility has had a deficit for the last 2 years. In 2015 and 14, your total fund balance for the sewer utility is unchanged at $369. The deficits in operations were $54,000 in 15 and $67,000 in 2014. There's a number of contributing factors as to why you had deficits in operations in the sewer utility, inaccurate billings, lack of billings, and we'll get into some of those other causes later when I go over the recommendations. Some other real quick highlights. You had about $24 million in cash at 12/31. You had no tax anticipation notes at all because you didn't need them. You had bonded debt of about $25.8 million, a debt percentage of 1.602 of equalized value. You're allowed to have 3.5%. You had short-term notes of about $6.6 million, leases of about $578, and the last of the parking meter lease was outstanding of about $88,000. You had no deferred charges, which means you didn't overexpend your budget. The only deferred charges you had was an emergency appropriation and the sewer deficit that has to be raised and is raised in the 16 budget. Tax collection percentage, you know you have an accelerated tax sale, so you would assume that you're going to have a very high tax collection percentage. Your tax collection percentage in 2015 was 99.92%, which is another record for the city. You've never had a collection percentage that high. Even with an accelerated sale, you could still have a 99.5 or 4, and those few percentage points mean a big difference. 99.92 is the highest you've ever had. So financially, good shape. Audit recommendations, we made 13 audit recommendations this year. Four have to do with community development block grant and the assistance to firefighters program. Actually, one has to do with the assistance to firefighter program, which is a relatively minor comment because one report was missed. The other four have to do with community development block grant. I'm not going to go into the details. Many of those, however, are repeat recommendations from the prior year. I'm also not going to go into every audit recommendation we made this year. You're going to have to do a corrective action plan. Just really quickly, we commented on bids, confirming orders, interfunds, business registration certificates, your data collection form, your data backup system, your disaster recovery system, which is basically non-existent even to today, your sewer connection fees not being collected, and the sewer billing. And since you had a deficit, I'll just expand on that one. The sewer billing deficit was caused by a variety of factors. One is that not all the use that was consumed by the residents was billed for in 2015. Approximately 1/12 of the use was failed, had not been billed. I'm thinking that the city will try and recoup that revenue in 2016. Additionally, the fourth quarter sewer bill, which typically goes out in December, did not go out in December. It didn't go out until early 2016. So 1/4 of your revenue billings didn't happen until the subsequent year. So I think those are the contributing factors there, and I think the city has a plan to get that straight. So that's my report, quickly, as it's hot. If you have any questions, I'd be more than happy to take them at this point.
Explain again what happened with, because a letter is going to go out from the city to every homeowner that they were not billed the right amount for a sewer bill. So explain that to get, and for everybody, so it gets in the papers, everybody understands it tonight, they're going to get another bill.
Okay. So the sewer bill has two components, a flat rate and then a consumption component. The consumption component is computed by receiving New Jersey American Water Company readings, downloading them into your admin system, and then that's what creates a bill. one month's readings from New Jersey American Water Company did not get downloaded properly into the Edmin system, and therefore it did not get billed. So that's why you need to make that billing back up, because it just was missed. There was only 11 months billed. There should have been 12.
Okay. So basically, I can go back to my bill. I think it was the fourth quarter of 15.
Yes.
And see, that bill was substantially lower because I was only charged 2 months instead of 3 months. So when everybody gets their bill, do the same thing, look and see that your last one was substantially lower.
Yes.
And just because the city only sent out a 2 month bill instead of a 3 month bill.
Yes.
A mistake on the city's part.
Yes.
What's the overall change in the total debt of the city, including bonds, notes, loans, and authorized but not issued debt?
All in, the all-in number, that's bond, just like you said, bonds, notes, authorized but not issued, loans, is about a $1.7 million reduction.
So we're doing good as far as getting old debts off and not adding new debts on.
You're and down 1.7 million.
As far as building up a fund balance, which some people call surplus.
Yes.
And as you said, we're in the best financial shape we've been in the past 3 years, so that's appreciated. Schedule 9C.
Yep.
What page?
There's no page numbers. It's... This is a listing of improvement authorizations that were bonded. And...
Oh, no, not bonded. It's all improvement authorizations that the city council passed. So every bond ordinance that the city council had passed for the general capital fund.
Right, and there's quite a few that have been held over for many years. Now, couldn't we either cancel these or reappropriate them to needed line items?
Yeah, if you take a look at that page, you'll see most of those old ones are pre-2008. They've been dormant for quite some time, and therefore, yes, it would be prudent to either cancel them or reappropriate them.
We looking into doing that?
That's next on the agenda. We just finished going through the trust accounts. We're going to, you know, next week or two, go through all the outstanding ordinances that haven't
trust
been
funds.
Yes, that haven't been looked at yet.
I mean, some of these are quite large, and we could use them for other areas because it's money just sitting in a different fund.
I think it's about, the total is about 280,000.
Yes.
Going to the sewer utility fund, Schedule 1D.
Yep.
I think you mentioned this in your recommendations. Sewer connection fees for the year were a total of $6,000. I know that number has to be wrong. I mean, this city is building every day, and somehow we only charge $6,000 for sewer connection fees.
That is one of the major deficiencies that we've been working on trying to correct. Our internal process is flat out broken. I've been working with staff over the last couple of months. We've made up the billings from last year. They would hit this year's books because once 12/31 hits, the fiscal year's over, obviously. But everything that was outstanding from 15 will be booked as a revenue in 16. So we have made those corrections. It's the internal process now to make sure that we get it done, but we have found all the missing money or money that wasn't billed.
And we're putting a system in place so this doesn't happen again?
We're trying to, yes.
Anyone else? Okay, thank you.
Any other matters by the city manager?
Now, do you read the recommendations?
I read them briefly. I'm not going to go over each one. It's too hot. But you'll do a corrective action plan on all of them.
And we adopt that? Okay, so that would be it.
My resolution should be for next meeting.
Okay.
Okay. And you have a group affidavit resolution as well that indicates that you're at least familiar with the comments and recommendations section of the audit.
All right. The affidavit will be distributed after the resolution is adopted.
And I'm not going to, so I'm not going to waste our time on this, but in the general comments on the first page, the last two paragraphs seem a little contradictory about regarding the excess in the bid threshold.
Right. The bid threshold comment was a repeat audit recommendation from the prior year. In 2014, we recommended that everyone that was required to be bid. We focused that mainly on SpectraServe and Delisa. Those two contracts had not been bid in 2014 and should have. In 2015, the bids were let, but they were let after the vendors were paid in excess of the $40,000. So that's why it's a repeat recommendation.
Okay. Any other questions? Good. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, we'll move on to public participation. Can I have a motion to open the meeting to the public?
Move it.
Second. All in favor? Aye. The public is expected to conduct themselves in a proper manner. Any derogatory, abusive, or threatening statements will not be permitted. The chair will immediately rule such conduct out of order, and after appropriate warning, may terminate any further comments from the speaker. I will ask that each speaker please state your name and address for the record, and you have 3 minutes to speak.
Okay. How you doing? My name is Curtis Barnes. I'm actually at a rehab right now, which is Cole Harbor. I don't know the exact address. I'm sorry. I just got there a couple of days ago. It's been like maybe a year and a half. I've been looking for housing. And I've been going through a lot, you know, trying to go on waiting lists and everything. And I'm not the only one having this problem that's actually in this condition. I have a spinal cord injury. I'm actually paralyzed from the chest down. And, you know, I am able to do things on my own. And I've just been looking for, you know, housing and haven't been able to find anything. And this has been going on for maybe a year and a half, like I said. And I'm not the only one going through this. I have a friend. He's in a rehab also. He was there before me. I was actually staying with someone else, but, you know, that didn't work out. So I'm actually trying to get my own place, and I see that I'm definitely not the only one going through this. So I'm trying to, like, get some type of help, answers, something, or maybe somebody can tell me what am I supposed to do. I mean, the waiting list is too long. I'm staying in a rehab now. I'm just trying to figure this out.
And you're trying to get housing in Asbury Park?
Excuse me?
In Asbury Park.
Yes, Asbury Park, Neptune. I've been a Lone Branch.
So I can talk to you after you're done, not Asbury related, but to my day job related.
Okay, I definitely would appreciate it.
But leave the information. How we get in touch with you, and we'll have either social services or somebody reach out to you.
Been to social services.
Well, then we'll have somebody else reach out to you. Are you a vet?
Okay.
Are you a veteran?
No. Okay. I'm actually not. I just grew up here. I've been here for years, 37 now.
Vets moved to the top of the list. That's why I asked. So.
Yeah, I know that, but I'm not a vet, sorry. So I just leave my information?
Leave some contact information and somebody will get in touch with you.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, next.
Anthony Williams, 305 7th Avenue, Asbury Park, New
Can
Jersey.
Can you say your name again a little bit louder?
Anthony Williams.
Okay, thank you.
305 7th Avenue, Asbury Park. I have a couple of questions. I've been here my entire life, and I live on the east side of town, and, you know, I watch the town. I watch the town flourish and grow, and I know this is a town of toleration, and it's multicultural and very, very diverse. And I was wanting to ask the city council, are there any plans at all, either initiated by the city council or by the developers, to do something on the east side of this town? You know, because I hear a lot of people, you know, there's a lot of buzz about Asbury Park. A lot of people talking about coming here, but there's two separate Asbury Parks, you know, and I know that, you know, if we don't make our voices heard, you know, we'll continue, like this side of town is beautiful. I mean, I really admire this side of town is vibrant. You know, it's a lot of businesses and people, you know, love this side of town. But on the other side of town, you know, it seems like no concerns have been addressed. That the playground that it was built, that's beautiful. But, you know, no one can live there, you know. So, you know, if there's going to be any type of affordable housing or any type of development or redevelopment on this side of town, you know. I remember, I'll say this in closing, I heard one of the members say that the developers had no intentions of developing over there. I don't know if that's true or not, you know. So if you can just speak to those issues for me. Thank you.
Hold on, we're going to give you a short answer. Michael, you want to go ahead?
Redevelopment starts with the land use, and the land use is permitted. So over the years, there's been a lot of amendments to the plans on citywide. So the plans have been written that are pushing for development and redevelopment. Tomorrow should be an interesting day, because there's going to be an announcement if the city and its partners have received funding for possibly two affordable housing developments on the west side, one with the Housing Authority and one with the city's developer, the Michaels Group. So you might have an answer to that tomorrow.
Do you know how many units that would be?
I think, I don't remember, Boston Way was 176?
Boston Way is 120 and Michaels Group is 64.
So it could be upwards of 200 units, all new. And then what is actually one of the more exciting things is the $500,000 housing choice grant that the city and the Housing Authority received. This is $1 million planning grant that's going to encompass everything. And when this planning grant is over in a year or two, what then it does is open up the next round of funding, which is millions of dollars for new development.
So we're talking about maybe three or four years before any groundbreaking will
The groundbreaking might start in 6 months, depending on tomorrow. So it's phase coming in. Tomorrow's going to be a big day. We'll know, you know, what could happen immediately. The housing grant that we received from HUD with the Housing Authority is another huge step. But what we've also seen is slight increases in the housing prices on sales. So there are things happening. It's going to take time. It's going to take a couple of years. But there's a renewed interest from the private sector to do things. So it's going to take some time, but the money's starting to come in.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Reverend John Bradley, president of the Asbury Neptune Ministry Alliance, and also the vice president of the Westside Community Center. I have three issues, but I'm only going to address two tonight, and I'm going to request a meeting with the city council and the city management concerning the redevelopment that we don't think had adequate public participation. The other meeting I'm going to be requesting is that we have it concerning the Westside Community Center. Now, I want to put you on notice that I will be calling to have a meeting either here or in the Ministry Alliance, either with the churches or at some location, maybe here. My concern here tonight is that I wasn't at this meeting, that we had to pay back $280,000 to HUD. And it said, my understanding, due to timelessness. And I have a problem with that word. And I want you to define what that means. Did we get the, we didn't apply for this grant in time? This is, by the way, the HUD money. What did happen? Why did we have to pay back $280,000? Now, who was responsible for this? And what had happened to prevent this from occurring again? Are we going to have training for staff? Or get rid of some staff? Or add some staff? So I address you tonight because the buck stops here. So I'm asking you, what happened to the $280,000? There were a lot of programs that could have been, that we could have had out of $280,000. We have children. Where all other people and other people that we could service. That's my question.
Thank you, Reverend. As you know, you're more than welcome to show up at any point in time, like anyone is, and we'll sit down and meet with you. I don't believe the number is 280,000 over the years, and if I'm wrong, you know, I'll be wrong on that. There has been, you're talking about two different things. One has been that there's been over expenditures in caps. For example, you might be able to use 10% of your grant for administration salaries. So over the course of the last few years, that number might have been exceeded to like 12%, and then the city has to pay that back out of the current fund. So over the last 2 years, there has been over expenditures and the city has paid back. This year's over expenditure, we actually think HUD has made an error, and we're going back to them because it looks like they footed the column wrong, and we actually don't owe anything. That was one of the audit findings, and we're going to work with HUD to obviously not try to pay that back. What's been done is, quite honestly, and Cassandra, who runs CDBG, will openly tell you, she's no expert in it. She never was fully trained. It put her in a bad spot, and she's been learning as she goes. One of the things that I brought to the table about upon being hired was I did run a CDBG program. So one of the things that we're making sure is we've actually asked many people to, in the next program year, to make sure a project is shovel ready so we spend the money. What we're recommending is for almost a 1 year cleanup where we're going to try not to do fund as many public services, which are more drawn out, more difficult to document, and do more bricks and mortar projects to spend the money, such as the money that was given to the Westside Community Center for your boiler. And moving forward, we hope it's going to be a 1 year aspect to get everything cleaned up. We've requested everyone that has open money on the timeliness issue to spend it. If not, we're going to take it and spend it ourselves because we can spend money quickly with that. Timeliness is 1.5% of your grant, 1.5% of your grant, which is 1.5% of your grant over an 18-month period. You can't exceed. So we've had some issues spending money. But those are almost finished. We should have the final amounts done by September with no more timeliness issues. And one of the things that, you know, as we've talked about when we've met, is that we've asked you guys to give us a 6-year capital plan so we can budget for that. So please, when you come for your next meeting, we asked for this in January, bring it, because then we can actually start budgeting better for CDBG and not have timeliness and spendliness issues. So that's what we're looking for, is from the nonprofits, from the organizations, to give us what you're looking for in the future so that we can actually budget and spend our money faster. So please, anytime you want, just
all
come.
Right, thank you. I had four or six seconds, I think. And I want to address one. That's an awful lot of money to pay out a person while they're OJT, on the job training. And I don't know how much time you allow a person to be on the job training. And we had a loss of that kind of money. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Carol Jones. I live at 1507 Bond Street for the last 35 years. We're having a problem, and I think it can be easily fixed. When the trucks, the delivery trucks from the beachfront come down 7th Avenue, they cannot get out of 7th Avenue onto Main Street because there's no light there. There can't be a light there because of the light that is on right next to the lake, Deal Lake Drive, thank you. What they're doing is they're coming down our one-way street. We've had 3 or 4 water main breaks in the last year or two. They come through the street, the tractor trailers, the beer trucks, the food trailers, everything is coming through our block because they want to get to the light on 6th Avenue. What we'd like to see happen is a sign put up on the last block of Bond Street, the 1500 block, saying no trucks, and putting a sign on Grand Avenue saying all trucks this way, so they can go across Grand to 7th and come down to the light there and get out on Main. It's been a problem. It was a problem last year, and we're finally getting around. I have a petition signed by everybody on the block, because the houses are shaking. They're knocking down the branches from the trees because the trees hang a little low. They don't belong on our block. It's a one-way street. So we would like some help from the city by just putting up signage, directing them to go down Grand Avenue and 6th Avenue rather than coming down 7th Avenue and cutting through our one-way block. Thank you.
It sounds easy, and it is fairly easy. Let us research it and get back to you, because I believe 7th Avenue is already limited to the trucks over 10,000 pounds. So if it's an enforcement issue, let us get together with the police department, with Officer Fiore, Chief Salerno, and see what 7th Avenue is rated for. And if they have to start ticketing, start ticketing. And it shouldn't have to go this far, but give us a day or two, and we'll get in touch with you.
Thank you very much.
Okay. We can ask all the beachfront people to have their trucks go up and down the right roads.
Mayor, may I add something to that? DOT a couple years ago changed the regulations on how to regulate truck traffic, as it is, in their opinion, an interstate commerce effort. So it is a very, very costly and time-consuming manner and method to actually get those truck signs up. It involves an engineering study. You have to make sure you have alternate routes. It's not an easy thing to do. So as the mayor said, we'll look at enforcement, but to put the signs up, I can tell you right now, it's almost a 9 to 12 month process because you have to do engineering studies. Thank you.
Marty Bradshaw, 1508 Main Street. I'm the owner of Burns Bradshaw Realtors. I just wondered if anything has been resolved yet as far as having the real estate offices added to the mercantile license list. I know Cindy said you might address it again in August, so I didn't know if anything had, we're almost into August, so I didn't know if anything had been done yet or if there's plans for it to be addressed again in August. And when I asked about this a couple months ago, and I read the definition of professional offices, of which a real estate practitioner was one of the 12 businesses on that list. I was told that those definitions only applied to Chapter 10, land development and regulations. And I looked at Chapter 4, general licensing, and I couldn't find any definitions whatsoever. So the only definitions for professional offices were in Chapter 10. So I don't know what if a new business came here and they wanted to open a new business in town and you weren't sure if they fell under the definition of a professional office or not, I don't know where you would look. I mean, where would you look? Under the definitions that I read? Or is there some other place where, you know, definitions appear? So that's my question.
Michael or Cindy? Because I remember this question being asked, and I remember the answer being she was looking at the wrong code. So she just said, okay.
And she's still looking at the wrong code. The land development regulations is Chapter 30. Chapter 10 is finance and taxation, and 4 is just general licensing. So real estate license is still mercantile and has to be paid. And the staff's not recommending a change in that.
Well, I looked under, no, you said Chapter 4. I read under Chapter 4, general licensing, and there's no... Cindy had told me professional services are off the books, meaning they don't have to pay. That's why lawyers are not on the mercantile list, doctors, dentists, accountants. There's 12 of them altogether. And the only one that was added, out of those 12, the only one that was added to the mercantile list was real estate agent. So I'm just, I mean, why were we the... None of the others appear on the list. None of the other professional offices appear on the mercantile list, the new list.
Is it just not on the list? It was just, we haven't met yet.
and there are no definitions of what the only definition of a professional office is in chapter 10. There's no definition in chapter 4, general licensing. So you said I was looking in the wrong section, but like I said, there's no other definitions anywhere.
Answer?
She pays. Real estate pays. Everything else isn't, and that's when we said we'd review it, and we're going to review it and make changes to it so everyone pays.
And what was your last thing you just said?
We'll review it when the time is right. We'll get it done before the end of the year. We'll put in regulations, and everyone should pay.
So it's going to be addressed again in August, or
by the end of the year?
Oh, by the end of the year. Okay. I just heard Cindy tell me August before. Okay.
We're busy. Elections Pardon? Are coming up.
What did you say, Cindy?
So elections are coming up, so August is going to be quite busy. So, but we'll get to it before the end of the year.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Susan Rosenberg, and I grew up in this city. I was educated here, and now I'm a trustee of the Asbury Park Historical Society. So, therefore, my address would be 508 Fourth Avenue. That's our headquarters. I want to thank the City Council for your support and for Madison Marquette in the vision of retaining the name Arthur Pryor Bandshell Pavilion to the history of the society and for the proposed bandshell, and we are very grateful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, my name is Nina Summerlin. I live at 1101 Bangs Avenue. I'm also the president of the West Side Citizen United Group. My question goes out to all the city council members and the city manager and the mayor. Our group met with you guys at the beginning of this year questioning about grant money that was supposed to be allocated to our group that we've been dealing with for the last 15 years. Our last conversation with you guys were this year because someone else was allocated our funding to do our back to school block party. We were told if we apply for a 501c and we did everything that you guys asked, that there was definitely going to be money set aside for us to actually house our program this year. When I first spoke to the city manager, I was told the same thing. Now I'm being told by Cassandra within the last couple of days or so that the grant money that we usually apply for every year to do nonprofit groups for funding for the senior party, we do the Valentine's Day dance. For our seniors, we do the back-to-school block party for the last 15 years. This year, we're being told that we will no longer be allocated any of that funding because you guys are using it for capital improvement. My question to the city council is, at what point did you guys not know that you weren't going to give that grant money to organizations to do A, B, and C? Because as you all know, at the end of the day, we are all volunteers in this community. We don't get paid to do what we do. So our money that we had allocated for our membership dues, we used in order to do what the city asked us to do, and that was to become a nonprofit. And if that were the case, our group would have never wasted that $600 to do what we did if we knew we were going to be pushed out the city.
You're not being pushed out of the city. You're not receiving, as right now, CDBG funds are not going to be used for the public service sector until we get that better handle. If you were here earlier, you heard me say that we've been looking at the trust accounts. This is money that has been in various funds for various reasons, and as the auditor said, with the capital, hasn't been touched in years. Well, as part of the trust accounts, we found money that hasn't been touched in years. So Cassandra's not privy to that information, but yes, we found some money in the trust accounts that are going to be able to do what you want to do. So she doesn't know that.
But my issue is really that we met with you guys, and if you knew at the beginning of the year that you had issues with your funding, why would you promise?
We didn't have issues that in the beginning of the year with the funding until HUD came through with their review in, I think it was late May, early June. So that's when we had to start to make the quick shift to make sure that we're in compliance with the regulations.
And at what point were your organization going to notify us after we met with you to let us know that that was not going to happen again
once
this year?
Once the fiscal year starts for CDBG and we get the trust accounts in order.
And so who would be responsible for notifying the group?
Well, that'd be me. And we've met numerous times, so...
And you still haven't informed me. I had to hear it out on the street.
Because it was 3 weeks ago that we finished the audit. Mm-hmm. We've reviewed the trust accounts. It takes a little bit more time to get this stuff rolling, especially when you're dealing with funds, as you heard the auditor say, that have been sitting idle since 2008. That's eight-year-old money that's just been sitting there not put to use. Okay. Citywide. So we're finding these things in these accounts, and it takes a little bit more than 3 weeks to notify people that, you know, there are going to be funding sources.
And how are you going to notify the group, though?
I was going to call you. But, again, it's been 3 weeks. And if you hear a rumor, you've
well,
shown up in my office, just show up and ask. Just show up and ask.
But I'm here to let you know from what I'm hearing, that's why I'm questioning it, because it was never brought to our attention that this is what their direction was. And like I said, if there was any inclination that this was going to happen, our group really wouldn't have wasted 90% of the funding that we do have to do what you guys have asked us to do since last year.
No, I don't disagree with that. But it happened 3 weeks ago when we finished the audits. You've shown up in my office. I've always said, just sit down anytime. This has been 3 weeks. It's going to take more time than this to get everything in order. Going back through, you heard the order, 2008 is capital money sitting there. And it's couple hundred thousand dollars.
Well, before I leave, I'll make sure I leave you my business card so somebody can get in touch with me.
Sure.
Thank you.
Tracy Rogers, Monroe Avenue. I'll make a statement and then question about two other things. I'm going to make a statement. Because the city delayed the process to deem properties on the abandoned list abandoned, along with not spot eminent domaining these properties, which have created an initiative to offer these properties to local residents for affordable housing at no cost to the city and created homegrown owners, the city has opened the door to shady investors with an opportunity to pass by the council and take these properties for little or no money. This goes to show that investors don't have the best interests of the city at heart. One investor is going to court, asked the Superior Court to usurp the city council's authority to give him one of these properties for $1,300. This investor just the process line in his own process. This goes to show the lack of community interest, but one of the financial greed over the best interest of Asbury community residents. I wish the city would reconsider the proposal I presented and work with a prominent housing agency that may wish to partner on this project. These are things that there may be thoughts that residents don't want to be homeowners, but they are. And there are also people here that also want to get into a training program to learn about building these properties. So I wish that you reconsider and look at what is best interest in that. I'd also like to talk about the CDG process. Right now, would we be able to get the communication from HUD as to what was the errors in this funding of money so we can actually get a clear sight, maybe being posted on the website to get what actually happened?
What happened was two issues. One, the previous CFO drew down $20,000 without proper documentation. What happens is when you do a CDBG program is it's a reimbursable, and he took the $20,000 first before we had spent the money to do the reimbursable. So that screwed up the financial side of it. And then the other side of it is approximately $14,000. That's like 13.8. I'm just rounding up to 14, where they're saying we overspent one of the caps. But when the auditors looked at it, they said that the column was footed wrong, and they're double checking of the math. So we don't know. We're going to go back to HUD to ask them to double check this. So the fiscal year 15 funds, we don't know if we have to pay back yet, because we're going to contest what HUD found, because we think they just did a footing error wrong in Excel. But so we don't know that. The previous year, the city paid back, I think it was approximately $14,000 again for the same issue. It was an over expenditure of a cap.
Well, that comes up to almost a little over $50,000. What are we talking at, $200,000?
I don't understand the question.
$200,000, what you added up to was about over
$14,000 plus $14,000 is $28,000. And we're contesting this year's $14,000.
But what happened with the 200 some odd dollars that were?
That I don't know. I've never heard that number. The next speaker might know because she's been there with it. But again, I can't sit there and dwell on the past if this was 3 or 4 years ago. Moving forward, we're putting things in place so that it doesn't happen again. And that's all we can fix is what we see and move forward and fix it.
But maybe we need to look at that 200, go back and look at that. That's not dwelling on the past. That's educating it so we don't also make that same mistake. If you don't, I mean, you haven't checked into it. But if there is.
The only thing that I know, and I know I don't know the dollar amount of it, was that the city improperly paid through the CDBG program someone's accumulated time, and then that reduced the grant in future years. I don't know if it was $200,000. I don't know if it was $50. That's all I heard. All we know is we've seen the problems. We've identified them. We've worked with the auditor. We're moving forward with it.
And the housing initiative?
For those of you who don't know what Tracy is referring to, the city has what's called RCA funds, regional contribution agreements. This is money from other communities to build and develop affordable housing. The city is approximately $2.4 million in funds to develop affordable housing. That first we must meet the contract. So when we met with Tracy a couple months ago, we said that there was probably 7 or 8 RCA properties that still must be developed before we're out of the 7 agreements we have. That right now the number is 4 or 5. So once that money is, once those properties are fixed, which is going to be probably about a year, we can petition the courts and do affordable housing plan, and then use the money for however we want. But that's a, you know, 2-2.5 year process to go through everything. Tracy's proposal is that we should take the money and buy homes off the abandoned property list, rehab them, and sell them. Is it a valid idea? It is a valid idea. But right now, with the abandoned properties list that Tracy referenced, there's roughly 13 that are still active. There was 33 on the list. People have rehabbed, sold them, done what they're supposed to get off the list. We have not been monitoring the list because code has been short-staffed for the last 2 months. This week, there's one inspector who did 27 inspections yesterday for certificates of occupancy. So we have not been able to keep up with the list. We have new inspectors coming on board. We anticipate updating the fair housing list. You know, fanning yourselves actually just makes you hotter. It's just a psychological thing. You can't hear anything. It turns into an airplane hangar in here. We've been here since 5, so this is, yeah. And like, everyone wants to speak tonight. So I'm dying. So Tracy's plan, it's a valid plan, but right now, as I've said in the past, we're not there yet because the private sector is fixing the homes, doing what they're supposed to do, sell them, demolish them. We're going to redo the list in the fall when we actually have staff to do things. Again, the process is moving. To do what Tracy wants to do is going to take 2 years, and by then, who knows how many properties are going to be on the list. We hope none.
I don't think 2 years, but the court case, the investor court case?
I think you're applying it wrong.
No, I got the documentation right here. A person filed in Superior Court and said he asked the city, and he's trying to get that property for $1,300 because you guys wouldn't say to him or give him a certificate that it was abandoned. And we do have properties that we can still do, and the process doesn't take years.
I honestly didn't hear a word you just said. For everyone speaking, please, right into the microphone.
Right now, those properties, this process won't take 2 years, but there's an investor that actually went to court and is suing the city to get the properties, which would over usurp the council's ability to deem that property abandoned. So right now, he can get it if the Superior Court gives it for $1,300, and he also broke the process in which he's doing it. And this process won't take 2 years.
Okay.
I don't know if you know about the court case.
I don't know about it, so if you give Mike, are you aware of it?
I've heard of it, I haven't seen it.
Well, I'm not aware of anybody suing us for $1,300, so.
I got the document.
If you could give it to Michael, and he can make us copies, and we'll gladly read it and get back to you.
Hi,
Lori Ross, Westside Community Center. Okay, so unfortunately, I guess the biggest issue is some miscommunication, some non-communication, particularly as it relates to those community development block grants. Michael, you haven't been here for more than 6 months, and actually—
9 months, Lori.
Okay, 9 months, okay. At the end of the day, this six-year plan you will get, only been a couple of months, but we've had issues, as you know, of getting the 2014 CDBG award. No harm, no foul to you or the council, but what it appears is that you guys don't know what your staff are doing and saying when you're not around. Let me be clear. For the city to hold a community development block grant application hearing meeting for technical assistance to tell people how to apply for those funds on a Friday at 4 o'clock, not being properly noticed in the coaster, is just indefensible. To continue to have audit findings, the same repetitive audit findings per Mr. Kaplan, is indefensible. You don't know the history, Michael, and the council is left, in my opinion, and many's, in the dark. Those CDBG funds, we would like to meet about them. We'd like to get the community engaged about them, because unfortunately, a lot of folks don't know, even with the capital improvements. I went to a meeting at Second Baptist Church, and they were astounded about the money. They want to be a part of it. And the reality is that the reason why people keep on talking about that $280,000 payment for timeliness back to HUD was because your community development director said it. So I don't even know if the council knew about it. You clearly don't know about it, but this is what was said at the meeting, that the city had to pay back $280,000 because of timeliness. And the conversation it ended up being because they breached the cap for administration. Again, you all are being misled and not fully informed, and I'm going to say including you, Michael. Unfortunately, even when I heard you were told that nobody showed up at the hearing last year, well, in fact, we did. Ms. Rita did, myself, another board member, and another resident. And we were met with two armed Asbury Park Police Department officers. And when we asked questions, your community director, development director said, I'm done, no more questions, and closed the hearing. So you don't know the history. And again, there are still some serious challenges with that. And even with the communication, Councilman Kendall had indicated about communication. Even with the Choice Neighborhood Grant, it's shocking to me. I'm a proud alma mater of Monmouth University. They're included in the grant, but you've got stakeholders in the West Side that are not even a part of that. So for Councilman Chapman, she has no idea who I am, what I am. I used to be a program monitor for those community development block grant funds. And the reality is there certainly needs to be some changes. Bottom line is, let's communicate and work together, because again, if your director is saying it, we can only take that as gospel. So the council doesn't know. I remember Mayor Moore said at least a year ago, when you had to pay back $150,000, he wanted to know what's going on, and that's before your time. So let's work together with community stakeholders, not just outside of Asbury, but in the West Side, whether it's at Choice Neighborhoods, which is supposed to help the west side of town.
Okay, Lori,
whether it's
a sub- Lori, I'm going to have to cut you off.
Just okay.
Just looking at the line and the heat tonight.
So my question is, what do we do?
Well, there's a couple things. I'm not trying to be sarcastic. You know I like you. But you heard about the meeting because you went. Staff sent it to the paper. It wasn't advertised. On Monday, when Rita brought up the question, I said that was part of what we've been doing, is trying to allow for more time in case there is errors, whether it's staff error, newspaper error, there's no heat in a room, we decide to cancel a meeting, which should have been tonight. We're making up space. So there is another meeting. It's actually two meetings, because I told Cassandra we should have two on Tuesday. I think one's at 10 and one's at 2. It's been advertised because, again, we did it the right way and allowed for more time. So it's been advertised. As per HUD regulations, it's been in the paper of record. We're fixing those problems. And I'm not going to say that anything different. The two audit findings, one was after the fact. And Kaplan, if he was here, would tell you this, was that it was after the program year had started when the audit had hit. So Cassandra didn't know in the first one. This one, quite honestly, isn't inexcusable because she knew about it previously. And we've talked about it.
Four findings.
And we've made the changes. And you've heard what I've said, and we've talked about this. So it is going to take some time. We're working on it. We're just asking for patience because there's a lot of things that we're going to make better. And you're here. You know you can always talk to me. It's not an issue to talk. We know that there's issues everywhere. We're fixing them internally, and
but
it's going to take time.
All I'm saying is that there's so many good organizations and individuals and facilities that need help on the West Side, and because they are not knowledgeable of it, they don't know about it, and we all just want to be included. That's all we're saying. Let's all work together. Let's all uplift this city. Let's all work together. That's all we're asking for. That's all. And it shouldn't be me that happens to look at your city to see what was on the agenda to say, oh, wait, you have a hearing today, and I happen to have been off. That's the only reason why.
Lori, okay, thank you.
She almost did it in 3 minutes.
Felicia Simmons, 300 7th Avenue, Asbury Park.
Speak up, Felicia.
Felicia Simmons, I can be loud. I was trying, it's hot. I was trying to save the energy. Felicia Simmons, 300 7th Avenue, Asbury Park. I'm here for a few reasons. Mostly is concern from the community. I speak on a regular basis about being able to live in Asbury Park, a city where I grew up, a city where I donate my time, a city where I love, and a city where I raise my children. Here, housing, again, is a severe issue. Just like that young man right here who's born and bred in Asbury Park, just like that gentleman right there who is Asbury Park, just like myself, just like a gentleman who it was too hot that now runs one of the largest nonprofits in the area, the Housing Alliance, the CFO, who is from Asbury Park. And then I'm also to speak about this community grant. When I looked at this community grant, I noticed that an entity which I shall not name, which I happen to be part of, is not part of the grant. It's not listed. People who are the heart of Asbury Park are not there. I'm here saying that we need to be at the table. People like that gentleman, people like that gentleman, people like everybody in the room, this is a beautiful, diverse community, and our voices need to be heard if we're going to have a plan that sustains everybody. It's a wonderful thing. There's future planning. We have to be creative. We have an opportunity. We stand at a milestone in time that can take us into the future for generations, generations and generations. We can look out for our kids and our kids' kids. We can't be short-sighted. We can't continue to fall into ditches. I can't hold you accountable for what happened in the past, but when you know that there's a ditch and you do not fill the hole, the sin now lies on you. So I'm sitting here asking to be included, to have a voice in my home, to be able to stay in my hometown, my mom's hometown, my friend's hometown, my son's hometown, my son's father's hometown, my community, which I grow in love and see the diversity and the growth. We want to be here and be heard. It's not a permission. It's our right to be heard here because all of our lives matter, but my black life matters also. And my black life here is important. It's important every day. And if my voice is not heard and someone speaks for me but does not know me, right? They can have the best intentions, but if they do not know me, they don't know my struggle.
I'm going to start off very brief. I'll let Michael follow up. If you're talking about, and you can say, John, I'm wrong, you're talking about that you're on the Asbury Park Board of Education, and that's the group you're referring to. The Asbury Park Board of Education has been CC'd on every invitation to the $500,000 grant and has not attended, which is totally, like, scary to us because there's
mind
so much
numbing.
Money out there that you could probably qualify and you're probably right on top of the line to get because of the work done by Tyrone Garrett through HUD and by Michael through the city, where this $500,000 grant is going to lead to millions, and why the Board of Education hasn't come to meetings is something you have to ask your administration.
I'm going to say I spoke to my board president.
Do I?
I spoke to my board president when I read this, and she had no idea.
But we send stuff to the administration.
Well, there's a board president, and there soon will be a liaison, so that will make communication better.
But you have a superintendent of schools. I believe, Michael, correct me. I believe everything went to the superintendent of schools.
Everything went to the superintendent of schools. There was no response. We just had our internal meeting with the housing authority about that Monday. You might want to ask Dr. Repelet about the email that I sent him, because there's a housing program for schools, which is, I think, $900,000 and opens up to a couple more million that was sent to him a couple weeks ago. Where I put in it, if you have any questions or need any help, reach out to me or Tyrone. Yesterday I asked Tyrone, have you heard from Repelet? And he said no. Well, so including
Repelet
everyone.
Repelet is having an issue right now, a family issue.
This was sent to him 4 weeks ago.
Oh.
So
I'm saying, as a person from the community and a board member, okay, I can't speak as I stand here. I'm a single individual, as your board, your council people know, right? I'm saying that this is something that we'll want to be part of. And actually, we have a board meeting this Thursday, tomorrow night, and this will be brought up, right? I can't speak about it. I have another board member sitting next to me who, and would you?
Okay.
So I'm saying this.
Okay, Lori, your time's
okay.
up. That's up. You can get in touch with
no,
Michael.
No,
Felicia,
I'm saying, and I'm,
Felicia, your time's up. Also, we have other people.
I know.
It's hot in here tonight. You at your Board of Education meeting tomorrow. You
yes,
ask your administration why they are not responding to our concerns. We want you involved. There's a ton of money there for the Board of Education. We're trying to help you get it, but we can't respond for you. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll take care of it tomorrow.
Okay, thank you. Next.
Hi, my name is Tyquell Rosa, 602 Comstock Avenue. And just got a couple questions regarding the police officers in the city. I'm not sure if this is true, but I hear they're supposed to be implementing body cameras on the officers. I just want to know, when is it effective, and will it be to all police officers throughout the city? And another thing I want to ask is something that Tony touched on. As far as the units they're supposed to be building on Springwood, Boston Way, or whatever, why nobody in the community works on these jobs? I watched them build the park, and I seen nobody from the community, black specifically, young men, and just wanted to spread light on that on these situations.
The jobs history on Springwood Park goes back a while. There are two Asbury residents who work there. We get the wage documentation, so we know that there's two residents there. We can't force someone to hire more people if they don't need more people. And that's the short answer of that. When the bids came in, from my understanding, and Fred, correct me if I'm wrong, they didn't need to hire anyone. And we can't force someone to hire somebody if they don't need to. Concerning the body-worn cameras, yes, we have body-worn cameras. We have enough for every single police officer. The goal was to roll them out all at once uniformly across the whole department August 1st. After the Dallas shooting, Acting Chief Salerno and myself talked, and it was get them out as soon as we possibly can, make sure everyone's trained on them, make sure all the notification is there, meeting the Attorney General guidelines. Some of the officers have them now just because of the shifts that they work. By August 1st, maybe the first week in August, every single person will be wearing them.
So there's nothing in contract or anything like that that says people from the community have to work on these jobs that's being built in our community?
It depends on the project. We can request it for certain things we can't request it. For that project, it wasn't able to be requested.
So what type of request do you have to put in so that people from our community can get on these jobs?
When there's redevelopers agreements, we were required, and the council has been very, very good with this, that there is a commercially best practices and various best practices of hiring local labor. We've done that through every single project. It's in all the redevelopment agreements that we have. We're in the process of getting ready to start collecting more data with it, but it has been a priority of this council for the 9 months I've been here and the years before that. So it's a process, but again, if you have someone that doesn't need to hire people, it's very difficult to do. And that's what happens in the public bidding process sometimes. Oh, God.
Good evening. Maureen Nevin, Deer Lake Drive.
As you know, I'm a journalist, and I happen to be on the board of the Society for Professional Journalists, and I represent the society on the Open Public, the Foundation for Open Public, you know, I knew
John
it when
Paff's
I came in here, I lost my brain. John Paff, right? What?
John Paff's stuff.
Well, the organization that John belongs to, yes, correct. Foundation for Open Government, thank you. Now, this pertains to the meeting where you discuss things in executive session, and specifically, I think there were about five different cases where people were asking for workman's comp, people who no longer worked for the city, and it was under the personnel exemption. So I asked John about it, and because it really ruffled me that a public body could discuss paying out money in a private session, come out before the public had access to the minutes from that meeting, and then grant these monies without the public ever knowing exactly what it was for. Yes, we could ask for the minutes later, but the horse is already gone. You know, these people are paid. You've passed the resolution. So this is, according to John, any matter involving the employment, appointment, termination of employment, terms and conditions of employment, evaluation of the performance of, promotion or disciplining of any specific prospective public officer or employee or current public officer or employee employed or appointed by the public body, unless all the individual employees or appointees whose rights could be adversely affected request in writing that such matter or matters be discussed at a public meeting. That is who the exemption applies to. It does not apply to former employees and even current employees who don't meet this. This is actually from NJSA, section 10:4-12, B as in boy, 8, if you want to look that up. So, and I think that actually the council has been meeting in executive session under the personnel exemption several times when it was not in compliance with this section of the law. So,
I'm going to answer it briefly and then turn it over to Fred because I believe we're doing everything proper, and I don't know if we're necessarily meeting under personnel instead of under litigation, which we can meet in closed exec. We're talking in litigation about closed exec, which is perfectly legal, that you can go into closed exec on pending litigation. And Fred, correct me if I'm wrong.
Yes, the workers' compensation matters are actually matters that are addressed as litigation, which is a separate exemption under the Open Public Meetings Act that allows municipal governing bodies to engage in discussions outside of the public realm regarding any pending or anticipated litigation. And there are a number of cases that are currently pending before the Workers' Comp Court, and as I indicated in a prior meeting, those matters are all handled by the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund on behalf of the city and attorneys appointed by the New Jersey Intergovernmental Insurance Fund. And as those matters are pending before the Workers' Compensation Court, there may be recommendations made by the attorneys who are representing the city's interests in those matters that are reported to the mayor and council in an executive session. But again, they're addressed under the litigation exception, not the personnel exception.
And can I add to that real quickly? Anytime that we do have a decision that has to be made that evening with regards to any of the closed session matters, the resolutions are posted ahead of time with the packet on the website. So anything that the mayor and council are acting on is well provided by Friday at 5 o'clock on our website.
And the resolution is, how is it described? Because
the resolution, the
packets that we get,
exactly how it's listed on the agenda. As
yeah,
the close,
and that's not sufficient.
How is that not sufficient? It has the title with the person, and it's a workman's comp.
But
just like it is tonight.
How are we supposed to know why somebody who worked here 3 years ago is asking for compensation
now? Detailed in a resolution. The resolution's provided with the packet online.
But you said it was exactly the way the agenda reads, which is only
the title,
a fragment.
But the resolution has the detail in it.
So the resolutions
has
have all the detail,
most definitely.
And they're online, because I didn't see that.
Yes,
I just
whole
saw
packet
the agenda
is
items.
Online. Not executive session topics, but if it's being acted on during open session, it's in that packet that's online.
Not if it's private session, though.
No, it's in the open session.
Well, this is my point, though.
But the exception, though, I think to what Cindy is saying is that if there is discussion planned in executive session for a matter, for instance, a workers' compensation case that the council's considering settling, and then they're planning to take action that same evening, the resolution that they will be taking action on during the public portion of the meeting is in the public packages. Right. Even though there's going to be discussion in the private session about that case earlier, the resolution that they will be acting upon in public is included in the public packets that gets uploaded to the web every Friday, or the Friday before the council meeting.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Rita Moreno, 8th Avenue. Resolution, I think it was 323, the bond issue. It wasn't clear to me Monday night. I'd like Michael to repeat exactly what we're doing there. I don't know if that $18,000 is in the $50 million bond, or, and I want to know who's getting it, if somebody is getting it. The other thing is, I asked Cindy today, I said, we'd like to meet the new CFO. Could she come to a meeting? And she said, well, you don't want to pay her. Pay her? I said, why would we have to pay her? Are you working on comp time, Michael, with the salaried employees? Shouldn't they be permitted to come to a meeting and not get paid if it refers to them?
Why would I want the CFO here right now? This is horrible. Well, we've been doing this. It's so hot.
No, not today, but I'm just saying, could we meet
you
her?
You are more than welcome to stop by her office and see her.
That's not the point.
That's the answer.
That's the answer. Okay, now the audit. It had a lot of errors. How come we keep making errors? I don't understand this. We have supposedly knowledgeable people working here, and every time we hear an audit, we hear errors. What is that about? I didn't even know my sewer bill was only 2 months. I think mine was $104. I don't remember. But I don't understand how there's always errors, and then you have money in the trust, $100,000 or whatever it is, and nobody knows about it. What's going on here? And I think I have the answer. I think that everybody that works in this city, in this building, they do their job, but they don't go any further than that. They don't go to the next person and say, well, I saw this in code. Say they saw something in code. They don't report it. They just do their little thing, and that's it. It took me 3 days to get an answer about how much it costs to be on the beach, if you want to rent the beach and what you have to do. 3 days. I mean, the person should be right there to tell us these things. What are they doing that's so spectacular that they have no simple answers? But anyway, could you explain that bond issue again?
Yes, for the second time I'll explain
it
to
you. Yeah, but you know, I'm a simple person. I want to hear it in simple language.
iStar spent money. They fronted the money. Now they want to get paid back. This authorizes them to get paid back once the engineer certifies that the expenditures are okay. I'll make it simpler. iStar spent money in the waterfront. They want to get paid back through the special assessment that is put on the property taxes. They want their money back. That's it. This authorizes them to get paid.
To get the $18 million?
Oh my God, this is horrible. If that's what they fronted, yes. Well, if they fronted $40, they're entitled to get the $40 back.
But the bond issue was passed after they started their projects. Why should we be responsible for that?
We're not responsible for that.
Well, all right. But the $50 million bond will pay for it? No?
no, this is pass-through money through the redevelopment area bonds. We have been through this before. Yeah, years ago, it was authorized that the infrastructure improvements were going to be $58 million. There's a special assessment on any new buildings in the waterfront. From that special assessment equals the $58 million. iStar has been fronting the money to do the improvements, and now they're asking for the money back. They could have said, okay, we're going to build a house, we'll get 50 bucks, and then do 50 bucks worth of road work. But they said, we're going to do 50 bucks of road work, then we'll build something, and then pay us back.
What about my other question about comp time?
No, I don't get comp time. I'm a salaried employee.
I know you don't.
Then why'd you ask?
Not you. I said the rest of the salaried employees.
The CFO?
Everybody. Anybody that's a department head.
We've been through this before, Rita.
No, we haven't.
Yes, we have.
Rita, your 3 minutes is up.
Yeah, but I'd like an answer.
I can answer that quickly.
After the meeting, you and Mike were going to talk. We saw quite a few people in line.
I know, it's hot in here. I agree. Okay,
so. And we still have our entire meeting, so just FYI, this is just the first part of our meeting. We actually have our entire agenda.
Jerry, no so budget Jerry, committee. GPS is coming. Thank you.
Jerry, I'm begging, make it quick.
Hello, Mayor and Council. Jerry Scrano here. Long Branch. And Michael, all I can say is I've been here when people showed up and when people left. That's my answer to your comment. Okay, now the cameras, are they going to have GPS on them? I like that question answered. Then the other thing is when David Kaplan, the auditor, gave us the information, I think that should be transcript, because I was quite surprised there weren't a lot of questions asked. I really was surprised. Because that's all kept rolling in my mind. What questions are they going to ask? So you need to see that in writing, what he said, and then figure it out. The other thing is, Michael Cavill just happened to say we're short-staffed. Well, I understand why we're short-staffed. I believe you need to do time and motion study and see what's going on with the city employee. The idea that things don't make it to the newspaper on time to be printed. There's a whole reason why things don't get done. No accountability. And if you're going to have accountability, you have to start from the department head. It starts with the new controller telling people what they're going to do or setting plans. Somebody has to be in charge. Once you get the budget committee, the city managers to give you their report, then you can decide what's going to happen. And then Michael can have goals, so we don't hear a year from now the goals weren't reached. You know, in real estate, the first thing they tell you is you have to set up a financial plan. How much money do you plan to make? It breaks down how many listings you're going to get, how many buyers you're going to waste time with, and how many deals are going to fall apart. The same thing goes with city government. You got to know your budget, and then you figure out work down and how to trim it. Every year the taxes go up, and every year the developers beg for abatements. The other thing is, I like to keep saying is, the developers are friendly people, very nice people in the room, but they're not your friends. And what I wanted to say is, you gave them the food court. We dealt with a lot of things that didn't happen. Now they want to redesign Arthur Pryor Pavilion. You got to get Sunset Avenue Pavilion. You want to see some plans on that, what they're going to do. They did a nice job putting graffiti on it, but now we need to see something happen with that building. You can't keep giving them stuff. You have to draw a line somewhere, and I really depend on you guys to do that. So could you tell me about the camera, that they're going to have GPS?
They don't.
Oh, well, thank you.
And Jerry, just so you know, several of us, it's not all of us, got in touch with Kaplan before tonight to ask specific questions. No, number one, we did not want to bore the audience. And number two, there was going to be 200 degrees in here and I didn't want to sit here. So I met with him for an hour and a half today. I know Eileen, I know Jesse Call, I know all five had been in touch with. We got this on Friday, so it's not like we opened it up tonight.
And it's online.
It's online, so yes, many questions were asked beforehand. Okay. Yes, sir.
My name is Tyrone Small. I live at 306 7th Avenue.
Can you speak up? I can't speak up.
My name is Tyrone Small. I live at 306 7th Avenue, Asbury. I raised on Madison Avenue. My whole family is raised in Asbury. We'd like to know why is the Asbury Park courts not, the lights not on for the youth? When we was growing up, we could go swimming at the Boys and Girls Club. The kids can't go swimming at the Boys and Girls Club no more. The task force is the main police force in this town that should have their body cams on because of the illegal activity they keep doing to the citizens.
Are you talking about the Prospect Courts?
Yes, the lights, the night lights.
They're going to be on starting Monday at 9:30. We've made it very clear to the organizers of this that one of the reasons why they were shut down last year was because of residential complaints. So the organizers understand that we don't want the residents, you know, being disturbed. And not just the residents in the vicinity of the courts, it's when kids are walking home. We don't want to see fights. We don't want to hear loud noises because we don't want to disturb the residents. So this is what was said on Monday morning.
Okay.
We're going to start the lights again up to 9:30 at night starting on Monday. If there's any legitimate complaint, we're going to talk to them. And if it continues, we're shutting the lights down because it's not just about the kids, but it's also about the homeowners and the residents in the area too. 9:30 is the curfew on the books. Everyone has to be home by 10. Everyone that we've talked to about this says 100% it makes sense. It protects everyone's interest. Starting on Monday at 9 up to 9:30 at night, the lights will be on. It's going to be up to the kids and the adults who are going to supervise this that no one screws up where we have to be the bad guys and say,
all right,
if you can't play, we're
in
done.
The same sense, Asbury Park Police Station is not armed security for Porter's nightclub. But every night, there's at least 15 cops standing there. So if they can't do that for the youth to make sure they get home safely, then why can you stand in front of this club? But then in the same sense, we used to be swimming at Boys and Girls Club. The youth can't swim there no more. They used to go swimming there every summer. We used to pay $5 and we used to go swimming. We can't go there no more. And then in the task force, that the main cops here should have cameras on. They're the ones that's doing all of the BS here. And it's like, there's no camps, nothing for the kids here. What do we have here? You build, that's what people complain about. You build the east side up so much. I live on 7th Avenue. Pardon my French. The Caucasian people ride their bikes over there every night with no lights. We come on the west side, my auntie lives. Every couple seconds, the cops are pulling a black kid over for riding his bike with no light. It's not equal. Ain't none of it fair in this town anymore. Like, no one's speaking up for the people because we don't have a voice over here because we don't have money. That's what the actual problem is. If we have money over here, somebody will speak up and fight for us. Everyone can say whatever y'all want here. It's BS because what goes on over here do not go on over there. And it does not happen. We could talk, I tell the cops, I play with the kids in front of my aunt's house. Mr. McGrath is, I think, is the vice principal of Asbury Barack Obama School. Every day last year, he see me play with the little kid Turtle. I donate to the Pot 1 League. He tell me, thank you. I ask him, can you tell the cops, stop driving through the school park lot. We'll play catch. I bought a basketball court last year for some kids. Every day, the cops still drive through the park lot. One of them almost hit my niece off a bike one day. Why are you cops driving through a school playground? You're their boss. We the residents from this side go to the police station and say something, they don't answer us. Then when we file complaints, they send a letter maybe 3 weeks later saying they ain't found no grounds. They don't even investigate nothing we say here. But there's no reason why the police car should be driving through a school playground. It would never happen in Dill. It would never happen in Ocean. It would never happen in Neptune City. It won't happen. My kid is no different from no one else's kid.
Okay, your 3 minutes is up, and I appreciate. If you would like to set up a meeting.
It's no, listen.
Sir.
No, listen, I'm going to say this, right? Because I watch how everyone got up and speak. Him and Miss Cindy, I watch your faces as people spoke to y'all. Y'all had a face of disgust,
hot.
Like you didn't want them to talk to
no,
you.
No, it's hot.
It's hot. Okay, have you been on vacation before? Yes, ma'am.
It's hot.
Okay, Mr. Small, if you would like to set up a meeting, And we had a meeting with your uncle to get the lights back on. Your uncle called me. Your cousin. And, but look, I have a listed phone number. You can come to my house. You can say, John, you're full of shit. You can come to my house and say, John, we need this. You can do that. You can come to Michael's office almost unannounced and sit down and bring these issues. You don't have to wait every 2 weeks to come here and tell us. That does nobody any good. Set up a meeting with the city manager, and I'll be there.
And I'll be there also.
Kendall, you know exactly what we're talking about. Kendall, you know exactly what's going on.
Okay, well, thank you. Please set up a meeting.
All right, thank you.
Motion to close.
Second.
Second.
Thank you. We'll move on to minutes. July 11, 2016 workshop meeting. July 13, 2016 executive session meeting. July 13, 2016 regular meeting. Can I have a motion to approve those minutes, please?
Move it.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? We'll move on to the consent agenda. Resolution 2016-314 approving special events, wedding applications as presented on July 25, 2016. Resolution 2016-315, resolution authorizing the payment of payroll in the amount of $1,033,566.53. Resolution 2016-316, resolution to credit sewer account 1505 Summerfield Avenue, Block 1403, Lot 14. Resolution 2016-317, resolution to credit sewer account for 1112 Sewell Avenue. Resolution 2016-318, resolution transfer sewer overpayments for 609 Ridge Avenue. Resolution 2016-319, resolution to terminate sewer account billing for 711 Madison Avenue. And resolution 2016-320, resolution to terminate sewer account billing for 205 Bond Street. Would anybody like any of the resolutions pulled from the consent? Motion to approve.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yeah,
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolutions 321. Accepting the 2015 municipal audit. Can you sign that and pass that down? Can I have a motion to accept it?
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-322. Resolution authorizing the payment of bills in the amount of $2,999,253.38. Mayor Moore must abstain from account number 601-23-220-00029. And Councilmember Chapman must abstain from 605-55-502-00021. And T-2056-850-915-801.
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman with those exceptions?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore with your exception?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-323, resolution of the City of Asbury Park declaring its official intent to reimburse expenditure for project costs for the proceeds of the RAB bonds. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-324, authorizing person-to-person transfer for liquor license 1303-33055-003 from Asbury Equity Liquors LLC to Hemmings at Asbury LLC. This is actually Pascal's and Sabine's for anybody who didn't know. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-325, rejecting request for proposals for architectural services for the ADA ramps for community development block grant activity. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-326, authorizing the award of lease of space, fixed space A, within the James J. Howard Transportation Center to Topps Taxi, Inc. Can I have a motion, please?
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-327, authorizing the award of lease of space, kiosk space B, within the James J. Howard Transportation Center, the Theodore Johnson J&A concession. Can I have a motion, please?
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-328, shared services agreement between the City of Asbury Park and the Village of Lock Arbor relating to the Office of the Tax Assessor. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-329, resolution of Mayor's City Council of the City of Asbury Park determining the development of the project located at 147 Borden Avenue, Block 1101, Lot 30, will address an existing housing need to the City of Asbury Park for home financing. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it. Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy
yes.
Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-330, authorizing settlement of workers' compensation claim, caption William Gray versus the City of Asbury Park. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Abstain.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-331, a resolution of Mayor and Council of the City of Asbury Park acting as a redevelopment entity regarding the application of Madison Asbury Retail LLC for conceptual review of the Fifth Avenue Pavilion proposals for the band shell and other uses on the roof of Block 4502, Lot 1.16. Can I have a motion, please?
Move it.
Can I have a second, please?
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Resolution 2016-332, appointments of the Sunset Lake Commission. The appointees are Councilmember Eileen Chapman as City Council Representative, William McClave, Superintendent of Public Works, who is the City Manager's Representative, Sue Henderson, Patrick Rayling, Mark Axe, Angelo Genisi, and Randy Moore. Can I have a motion to approve this resolution, please?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Ordinances for introduction. Ordinance 2016-23. I believe this one's going to be pulled. Am I correct, Michael? Ordinance 2016-32, bond ordinance amending and supplementing bond ordinance number 3036, which provides for the reconstruction of the footbridge at Sunset Lake, heretofore finally adopted by the City Council of the City of Asbury Park in the County of Monmouth, New Jersey on January 16, 2013, as amended and supplemented heretofore to increase the appropriation by $150,000. Can I have a motion to introduce this ordinance, please?
Move it.
Have a second?
Move it. Second.
I'll take it a second. Okay. Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Public hearing is scheduled for August 10, 2016.
Just a question. I'm sorry. 23, why was that pulled?
Because it wasn't provided?
Yeah, I'm having formatting problems. I should have it fixed and finished by the end of the week.
Is this the Animal House?
No, this is
the next one that we're doing is the Animal House.
Okay.
Ordinance 2016-33, an ordinance creating Chapter 13, Section 5, Chapter 13, Property Improvements and Neighborhood Preservation Rental Properties. Can I have a motion to introduce this ordinance?
Move it.
Second.
Comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Public hearing is scheduled for August 10, 2016. Ordinance 2016-34, an ordinance establishing salaries to certain employees of the City of Asbury Park, Monmouth County. Can I have a motion to introduce this ordinance?
Move it.
Comments or questions?
Question. When you say certain employees, who are you speaking of?
This creates a salary line for a transportation planner, a new position.
Other comments or questions? Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore?
No.
Public hearing is scheduled for August 10, 2016. We're on to second reading public hearing ordinance 2016-31, an ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 7-16 entitled Angle Parking of Chapter 7, Traffic of the Code of the City of Asbury Park, New Jersey. Can I have a motion to open 2016-31 to public?
Move it.
Second. Maureen Nevin, Deer Lake Drive. Okay, so this ordinance doesn't seem to say very much at all about what the plan is. Could you fill in the blanks?
What the plan is?
What the ordinance is.
To put angled parking on the north side of Deer Lake Drive between Kingsley and the DOT right-of-way.
Where is the DOT right-of-way?
Well, it's about, guessing, 30 feet east of the bridge. Their property goes past the bridge. So right now, cars are parking in there illegally.
Parking in where illegally?
In the DOT right-of-way. They're parallel.
So it's about 30 feet from where the bridge starts?
Yeah, 30.
Heading west?
And I'm heading east.
Heading east.
You have the bridge.
So across from the Santander?
No.
The other side of this.
Right.
The east side of the bridge.
East side of the street. Okay.
The northeast side of the bridge, the DOT right-of-way goes past the intersection, and I'm guessing about 30 feet. It could be 28, it could be 25. We cannot put angled parking in there without their permission. So we're trying to get their permission, but we wanted to get this up and running as quick as possible because it adds about approximately 40 new parking spots for that area.
So it's still going to be the 40 spots then?
Yeah.
Even with that 30 feet?
Even with that, and we just didn't want to take a chance and put in the DOT without their permission and then them squashing everything. We'd have to go back to the drawing board.
And what's the time frame?
Time frame is, what is it? Today's the second reading. What, 15 days after? 20 days after? 20 days after this.
It'll start 20 days after this?
After publication. After publication, we'll...
The construction, that is.
Let's do it as quick as possible.
We need it.
Today's the end of July.
The ordinance will be effective 20 days from final passage from tonight, and then the city will be free to restripe.
So 20 days from today, I would like to see DPW on the 19th, they put up sign, road closed, no parking, you will be towed, and then all we have to do is go out there and black out some of those spots, put in new parallel spots, number them, and it's over with.
Number them?
Only up to Webb Street, only where the numbers are now.
Okay, so we're not adding any new meter?
No new numbers.
Okay.
There will be new numbers because obviously if you're going from parallel to angled, you're creating new spots, but it will not go past Webb Street. It will stay within the boundaries.
Okay, thanks.
So I would love to see that done 20 days from now.
Motion to close?
Move it.
Second.
Motion to adopt ordinance 2016-31?
Move it.
Second.
Councilmember Chapman?
Yes.
Councilmember Clayton?
Yes.
Councilmember Kendall?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Yes.
Mayor Moore? Mayor Moore?
Yes.
Motion to adjourn?
I guess you didn't
move
hear
it.
The first time.
Second.
No, I did not. Neither does she.
Because you're making invisible faces.
That's because I'm like...